Charles? We have a few extra microphones up here, so please take one when you're going to eat.
I was struck by your formulation near the end that silence is not the answer. And if I got the words correctly, you said we need our rituals, went on to say more. What kinds of rituals do you see as meaningful? How are they related to tradition? How are they new? How do they, that's been my experience in terms of major illness, but how do you answer it coming from where you had come from to where you are now?
Well, is this mic on? I'm very careful about not telling other people what I think they should do, because I barely know what I should do. I'm certain of only one thing, which is that we can invent new rituals. We can throw out old rituals. We can use old rituals, but give them different meanings, as certainly the Jewish women's movement has done. I mean, we've built on the past, but changed it slightly. What I think we can't do is be too ignorant. That is to say, we can't allow ourselves not to know all kinds of things, whether it's how to read a passage in the Talmud, whether it's to read a piece of Torah, whether it's to know exactly. The other day I realized I had all the Israeli wars mixed up in my head, that suddenly Israeli history had jumbled, and that I needed to unjumble it. I mean, that we need to know what happened to us 20 years ago, 500 years ago. I think what I'm insisting upon is a connection between traditions, rituals, and knowledge in some way. Now, exactly how any given person is, or any given congregation or any given community is going to figure this out, I don't know. But we can't offer our children something that isn't intensely alive with their past and their future.
Joe? Yeah, I'd like to thank you for being so autobiographical. And I hope I'm not taking advantage of the opening that you provided in terms of talking about yourself, but I'd like to, with respect, just push that a little bit further. I was really profoundly moved by the fate of your brother. And as you led up to the conclusion of that reminiscence, that story, I came to a very different conclusion. I thought you were going to say something else, and of course it's the projection of my own values, but I saw in your brother's refusal to engage in discourse with the Almighty and wanting you to respect that, I saw in that myself, and these aren't necessarily your values or anyone else's, a statement of authenticity, a desire to live out and die with a sense of courage, and a desire to die free of what he would have construed to be illusions. And in that sense, I saw that as a very affirming step in the silence. In other words, the silence spoke to me very, very loudly. And I think it was to remain silent at the grave was an act of tremendous respect that carries with it a type of almost transcendent feel in terms of the linkage that you had with your brother's wishes in the face of death. And I come to a very different conclusion as to its significance. Now, of course, you know that better than I do because you knew your brother and I did not. But that was just what I read out of it. And a second question, looking forward to the future generations, I want to pick up on something that you had said when Professor Cantor had spoken earlier, in terms of how does your formulation of the Jewish people having a purpose, which in effect you really can't articulate or flesh out, how does that fly with your children? Because it seems to me that that type of approach has to rest to some degree on evidence. And it may be very subjective evidence, but maybe your children haven't had the same experience, and therefore the evidence that they bring to that type of approach may not be compelling for them. So the question is, how do you develop a compelling argument out of the approach that you present?
Let me take the first part, which has to do with the silence. I'm sure that that everybody who heard that thought of it somewhat differently. I can only report to you how I experienced it. And what I experienced, what I thought of, was if everybody had been standing at Sinai with their back turned to God, what would we have had? I thought of it as a kind of cultural absence, finally, because we live in culture. We don't live inside of our own experience only. And the moments when we are most connected to the culture are these moments where you have devised a program, where we are born, where we are married, where we die, where we're not just our single selves. The other thing I have to say is that silence is unbelievably uncomforting. It won't do. It will not make it possible for us to be one next to another, bound together. Now, I mean, this is just a single story, but if you think of it multiplied, if you think of all of our children unable to say anything, if you think of the Kaddish as disappearing, and you think of a vast silence out there, it's pretty dreadful. And I don't see any way around that feeling. I mean, there's a certain honor in it. There was a certain honor in Masada too, but I thought it was, definitely the wrong way to go. as to evidence, the reason I told you that this was historic mysticism first was to tell you that I know this is not a scientifically, logically provable point. I know that it risks creating a religion under the religion, a religion built on history as opposed to being built on Torah. That's the intellectual trap. I don't see any other way out. I mean, if anybody has one, please tell me. It seems to me that if we stop believing, not necessarily in some superiority idea of our being the illumination of the world, but if we stop believing that we have some particular purpose in this mix, then we stop believing in our need to stay together. And I still believe in it. And so do you all, you wouldn't be here.
Yeah. Thanks so much for that wonderful presentation. I liked in particular the metaphor of the three-legged stool explaining the views and what the elements of being Jewish is for the modern Jew. The Holocaust, Torah, and Israel. But then you stopped and went on to talk about other things, and I said to myself, three-legged stools are not very stable. And then you concluded by adding, for me, the fourth leg, when you said there has to be meaning and purpose. Then Joe wondered, well, that's not too rational. Therefore, how could you explain that convincingly to your children? I think that that explanation to my children speaks to their spiritual hunger and search. And they like to hear that. They're not really totally convinced by rational explanations. And I think there's a little more than this being in the non-rational domain, because all I need to do is to point to 3.5 millennia of history and the record of Jewish life and performance to say, and for them to nod, yeah, I guess that is a particularly special people. Now, what is its purpose about? And let me figure out how I buy in to that culture and that history and let it give direction to my life.
Okay. Yehuda.
I have a question and a comment. The question really, on the face of it, deals with how you see the relationship of diaspora and Israel Jewry as building the Jewish continuity. In what sense? Because as you know, as we all know, there is a kind of accumulation of errors where the Israeli establishment is telling diaspora Jews, we don't want your money because we've become independent, and not realizing that it's not just the money. And diaspora Jewry saying, that's wonderful, we're going to increase Jewish education, and they spend it on other things. And the whole relationship is missed, instead of becoming a partner. You know all that. Now, how do you see it from your point of view? And the comment is that what Bernard Reisman just said, you know, there's a difference between a special quality of the Jewish history and the meaning. Purpose and meaning, when you don't give meaning to meaning, then it has no meaning. And what you did, I think, was going intuitively, searching for something, because it would fortify your identity. But you cannot invent something artificially, because then the identity won't rest on a solid foundation, I feel. I don't think that the Holocaust had a meaning. It had the meaning only for the Nazis who did it. For the Jews, it had absolutely no meaning. We give meaning to it in retrospect, in the sense that Yaakov Malkin mentioned, and that's, I completely agree with him, and with you, your comment, and that we identify with a past that preceded the Holocaust. We want to continue something that was stopped by force. But that's not the meaning of the Holocaust. The Holocaust has no meaning. Jewish history is the history of a special people. If you look at quite a number of other nations and ethnicities and so on, each one of them says, my history is very special, they're perfectly right, and it has a special meaning, it has a purpose. We are here by some transcendent authority to give purpose to this world. It's a good thing psychologically, but I don't think that in a modern world it is in any way sufficient to form the foundation of the continuity, especially of a group like the Jewish people, who are faced with a problem of modernity or postmodernity in an open society where you have choices. You can be we are one nation under God. We are, America has a special purpose. Everybody has, the Danes have, I know that. And the country where I just happened to be born, with which I have no contact, but I know the language, I know the legends, the Czechs. You go to Czech literature, good heavens, the Jews are just like them, and they are just like the Jews. They have a special purpose in history. They were created by Almighty God in order to fulfill a special purpose. I don't want to be in that company. And I wonder what you would react, how you would react to that.
Look, essentially, I agree with you. That is the rational position. Certainly, the danger of believing in your own history is that it turns into some ugly kind of nationalism. It's then something that entitles you to do something bad to somebody else. And then it's just as bad as religion. It is something very ugly. However, I am concerned how else would you say to me, how else do you convince me, not that not that Jews are wonderful people, better than everyone else, or that my particular branch, the Ashkenazi branch, is better than everybody else, but how do you convince me that it matters? And maybe it doesn't matter. I mean, it has crossed my mind. It has crossed my mind that we may end up with a America without Jews in it in another 7,500 years. Certainly, you know, this does not rank among the great disasters of the world, maybe, but I somehow feel like it's a disaster. So, you know, how do you explain this thing that we're all doing here? Why is everybody, why is Hadassah dragging me all over the East Coast to talk about making more Jewish women if it really doesn't, if it only matters if you're a triumphalist? I am not a triumphalist. You're not a triumphalist. I'm groping for some kind of other way to hold on. And if when I sit and I listen to all this and nobody discusses meaning, I'm sure we're in very, very bad trouble, which is why I'm at least proposing this historic mysticism as a kind of, I don't know, it's a possibility. But I agree with you.
I propose we have a plethora of paper and a handful of hands raised. In order, Zev, Egon Meir, and...
I'm
sorry. Well, what I propose is to call on in order of my having recognized them, Zev, Egon Meir, and Charles Silberman. And then I want to reach some of the questions from the audience, and then we'll return, time permitting, though I think we will have, to Herschel. And so you'll be our last, Herschel, unless time allows. So let me go now to Zev Katz.
Oh, I'm sorry. Well, you talked about the terrible contradiction between everybody was had great rabbis or rabbis as their ancestors and then tailors. But there is no contradiction whatsoever. Everybody, every tailor was a Reb Menachem Mendel Taylor. Reb so-and-so, Reb Tuvia was Tuvia the Milchiker, Tuvia the milkman. In our childhood, in the shtetl in which I was born, even the water carrier was addressed Reb, and even the beggar, when he came to ask for money, was regarded as Reb Shmuel, was with you, Geld with you. So there's no contradiction between these two, if I may say. About circumcision, of course, all the ancient Near East, but for the Philistines, were circumcised. If you go, can you hear me? All the ancient, or almost all the ancient Middle East, before the supposed exodus of Jews from Egypt, were circumcised. If you go now in the Israel Museum, the Bible Land Museum, you'll see on the wall a relief showing in ancient Egypt, 1800 before the Common Era, a circumcision with, of course, stone knives, haravot tzurim. So there's nothing we invented. Only the Philistines were arelim. And in the fight with the Philistine lines, you know the story about Samson, how he brought, what was his nadin, and so on. About Ezra and Nehemiah, many great specialists now think that only very few really heeded to Ezra and Nehemiah, and only on the elite. The rest all left their previous wives and children, because otherwise how, from several tens of thousands of returnees in a short time of the Second Temple, we have a Jewish population of 1 million, 2 million, 3 million. And the final point, I would like to follow what Yehuda was saying. A purpose could be mystical, just like the Torah, given from outside. A purpose could be something given by ourselves. There is no doubt in Jewish history that the Jews, for a long time, perhaps more than the Czechs, perhaps more than others, believe that they have some purpose, that they have to be some exceptional people. They have to make an exceptional contribution. Maybe it is this that you have in mind. Then we don't have to be very mystical about it. The only thing we have to say, that historical evidence seems to show that this is an inborn trait of the Jewish people in all generations. And God forbid, can I say here, God forbid?
God forbid.
God forbid. We should forget, we should want to be like some of our Israeli thinkers, people think we should be like the Danes, raise pigs and everything will be fine. God forbid that there should be, that we should not try to be an exceptional people and have an exceptional purpose without having it as a mystical thing from outside. What would you say to that?
I feel that I'm a little bit over my head as a writer, that I'm concerned that I'm going to, you know, make shreds of some kind of philosophy, or I'm going to, you know, make a logical mess out of some kind of historical analysis. And so I'm going to back off a little bit. And just as an ordinary Jewish person, say, whether it comes from the outside, whether it comes from the inside, whether I meet a you know, a friend on the street who can tell it to me, or whether I find it in my dreams one night, I need some sense of meaning to my life, something that cuts against the existentialism, which I also profoundly believe, something which creates a balance of social, adds social purpose to my life. Now, it would be wonderful, I would love to be able to formulate it and, you know, package it and God knows what else I could do with it, but I don't have it. I just have a vague yearning for it, and I suspect, you know, I suspect my yearning must be equal by most other, you know, what we will call ordinary Jews.
Egon?
Thank you. I want to pick up on a very small piece of the exchange between Charles's first question and your response, because it was so intriguing. Charles asked you essentially what particular rituals you would find compelling, and your almost instinctive, and I think it was almost instinctive, response is, well, I don't want to tell other people what to do. And yet you shared an incredibly poignant story with us in which you recognized, I think, that you need certain things for comfort. Now, I think that that term comfort is a very compelling argument, and it reinforces precisely the point you just made, that it doesn't really matter that much to the comforted whether the source of comfort is from on high or from below. The question is, does it give comfort? And I think that the premise of our discourse today is almost intentionally denying the real questions that trouble people. That is, I don't think that the masses of unaffiliated Jews or even affiliated Jews are waiting for us or anybody else to come up with a coherent, well-reasoned, historically substantiatable argument as to why be Jewish. They frankly don't give a damn. They are going to march very rapidly to other sources of comfort in the face of broken lives, in the face of death, in the face of divorce, in the face of all the other social ills that we're all heir to as human beings, not just as Jews. And I think we as a community, and I emphasize it now as a community rather than as individuals, I think the community is doing a major disservice to the seekers of comfort in carrying on lengthy debates about esoterica that don't touch the heart.
I'd like to pick up on the dialogue we had, just to comment that I think you and Yehuda defined another central issue, which is how do we define, maintain a sense of distinctiveness without denigrating other people. That the challenge to the need for a reformulation of Jewish identity, religious or secular, in if we really mean what we mouth about pluralism, is enormous. And in the past, implicit in our self-identification has been a denigration of others. When I heard, I had a different reaction to your poignant story of your brother's burial than Joe did, because my first reaction was to feel agony that despite the richness of his yeshiva, education, he somehow had not learned that there is a long, rich tradition of anger against God, attack on God, that we are not the first generation to have struggled with the question of evil. And in the Book of Lamentations, Echa, the response to destruction of the first temple, there is a bitter parody on the 23rd Psalm. The one poem, the only one of my favorite of Yehuda Amichai's poems that he did not read last night, was a absolutely superb, wonderful, bitter parody on El Malei Rachamim. And so there's a long tradition of using the tradition against itself, sacred parody, as it's called. In terms of, you know, as you were talking, what I was hoping to evoke from you was the kinds of rituals you find meaningful. My own, if I can be autobiographical, when I was in the hospital after cancer surgery and a stroke, I was not asking questions about God, why me? I think I'd been trained to ask, why not me? And I had learned to think of God as a non-supernatural being, or therefore wasn't responsible. But when I was barely able to move, I found myself spending half the day on the phone with the chaplaincy department at New York Hospital, because the rabbi had been there the day before, trying to get a set of electric candlesticks, which I finally got. And my wife brought Kiddush cups and some wine and challah. And we found tears were flowing extraordinarily, and extraordinarily healing power in the ritual. Serious illness fragments the self. Your sense of self is utterly shattered. And somehow the lighting candles, chanting Kiddush, making motzi, connected me with a sense of wholeness again. And what struck me afterwards in thinking about it is that the rituals that have the most meaning, the greatest healing power, are the rituals that connect us to past, present, future. There is a kind of hopelessness when you're seriously ill. You're embedded in the moment, and the rituals connected me with my parents, my grandparents, my children, my grandchildren. And so I was hoping, if you have difficulty with a purely religious formula, I'm comfortable with that. Clearly, many people here would not find that comfortable. What kinds of rituals do you find satisfying for yourself, and how do they connect to Jewish tradition?
I find that I'm still groping along the lines of which traditions I wish to keep, which traditions I don't want anymore. I know that I want traditions, including I very much would like a Din Torah, in which in every single synagogue and temple across America there ought to be some day, some time, some place where one can call God to account for his sins. That would certainly be a very nice addition. I would also like to have it very clear, and that reason I told my story about being a child inside of a synagogue is I would like to make it very clear to every child that faith is not the only handle for the Jewish religion. And it may be that if you stop believing in the Immaculate Conception, you ought not to be a Catholic, but you don't. There's something far more flexible going on within Judaism, so that should be made clear, because it isn't always so clear if you're 12. However, these are very, very private matters, because we do come with this other problem that has to do with reason. You know, we are rationalists. We are, you know, here I am. I'm told, I'm worrying all the time. Can I prove what I'm saying? Is it, do I have backup evidence? Is it on the paper? Where did I get that idea from? How is my unconscious playing into this? What is my unconscious preventing me from seeing? With all that going on in the head, it's very hard to simply light a candle. You really have some trouble, and we have to deal with all that. I mean, not just me. And I am being purposely evasive.
Here, I'm devastated. Yeah, I'm devastated because having been enamored of you for 14 years, I now have to disagree with you.
I thought that was a sign of being enamored.
If Paula were not right outside the door, things would be looking up. But my disagreement, and I'm going to try to embrace some of these questions, is your notion that this is private. It, I think, precisely cannot be private. If we are seeking responses to a community, for ourselves and to an unaffiliated community, then our private responses must be made public and communicated so that we can come up with a variety of solutions, a variety of ritual. Then, and I don't, you can respond if you will, but I don't think you have to. A number of the questions here relate to ritual. The concerns expressed on the panel are replicated in the audience. What did you mean by ritual? What do you tell your children? How do you communicate this sense of Jewishness through ritual? And so I think that if we are to answer why be Jewish, and implicit in everything we've done this weekend is tomorrow's how do we do it, I think it's not, if I dare say this, to have this remain private is to stand silent.
I do want to answer this. I think maybe we had a problem about private, the word itself. I didn't mean that we should do our rituals in private. What I was trying to avoid is saying my conservative Judaism is the way what we should do. Your version of Reform Judaism is not quite what I would accept for these seven reasons. That I don't think I think that's pointless and unnecessary in our community. When people ask me, as somebody in the audience undoubtedly did, even though I can't see it, do you still have a Christmas tree? I knew it. I always say, I answer that question privately when someone comes over to me, but publicly, what I want to say is some members of your community will have Christmas trees. Some of them have intermarried children for whom the Christmas tree means a great deal. Some of them will never have a Christmas tree and will always look at themselves and do an equivalent of whatever Jews do when they cross themselves when they see a Christmas tree. Fine. It's not for me to make a public pronouncement about how we proceed on these issues. Now, what I will tell you is if I were to start all over again, if I were pretend I am 20 years old, I know what I would do. I would do what I didn't. Remember, history has many factors in it. One of the things that was happening when I was 20 was there was no feminism in this country. As a result, there was Zionism. I picked it up. I heard about it. I didn't come from the kind of home where it was, you know, around, but I knew there was Zionism. And I thought, how wonderful to go to Israel. How do I get to Israel? Well, I figured it out. I will go to the Metropolitan Museum, and I will walk through the museum, and some Israeli soldier on some kind of a furlough visiting some kind of a relative will find me in the museum, fall in love with me, and take me to Israel.
And
what happened was, It took Betty Friedan. It took a whole change in our consciousness. And one day, sometime around 1975, when I was already remarried, already with five children, I suddenly said to myself, you know, I could have gotten on a plane and gone myself. Now, if I were 20 years old, I would go to Israel. Because let's take this stool here. We have the land, we have the people, we have the Torah. The Torah, I have complicated feelings about. The land, it's pretty simple. Politics aside, at least, you know, we can have a good, clear argument. The people, I feel completely connected to. So I would have, that would be my solution now. Now, the other thing I would do, if that didn't happen for some reason, is I would become a very observant, traditional Jewish person. And I would have a very observant, traditional Jewish household. And my children would have rebelled against it by now and be long gone. But I would have, that's what I probably would have chosen to do. That assumes that I could tolerate, I get bored easily. And if they say the same thing 10 times, I get bored. So perhaps I wouldn't have done it. But in my head, in terms of what I think, if the community were to come to me and say, what shall we do in my dreams? And I certainly feel as many of us who can move to Israel should move to Israel. We should certainly get our young people over there as fast as we can and have them stay. And not only that, they should vote for Labor. And as many who stay here need to move in the opposite direction. They need to be traditional. They need to keep the tradition alive. Now, this has, you know, I'm going to be 60 years old. This is a different subject for me. I bring with it. I'm in a different moment in my life. If one could only send messages back in time, if one could only do things, certain things differently, we would all do something differently, wouldn't we?
By the way, I just wanted to inform Anne that Ashkenazic Jews are genetically predisposed to say poo, poo, poo when they see a Christmas tree.
My mother told me that's what you do when you see a nun.
We're all very grateful.